Blog Talk Radio.
All right.
God is my source.
God is my
source. He's my provider. God is my source.
You're listening to When Christians Speak Online Talk Radio, broadcasting out of the Washington, D.C. metropolitan area. Today's voice crying out in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord. When Christians Speak is dedicated to lifting up the name of Christ Jesus and spreading the good news.
So it's my brother, can you spare a dime? My God shall supply my need. Don't have to beg because I am a thief. Cause every good and perfect gift comes from the Father who I
am. Oh. All right, praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. It's Friday Night Joy. I'm your host, Reverend Ray. We are broadcasting on When Christians Speak Talk Radio today, and I'm excited to be here with you. Like, I got everything back and ready. This is the first live broadcast we've done in a while because we're having some audio problems, but it sounds like everything is working according to plan. I'm glad to be in the midst with you, glad to be able to share with you on Friday Night Joy tonight. Reverend Robin may be joining us. I'm not sure yet, but we're going to go on and continue on When Christians Speak Talk Radio. Before we do all that, I want to remind you real quick, amen, of some of the things that we got coming up. We got Here's the Abounding Grace with Minister Vanessa Williams. It's every Tuesday at 7 p.m. We got Declaring the Principle with Reverend Pat Randall. That's Thursday at 12 noon. Friday Night Joy. We got the first and the third Fridays. First and the third Friday. First, the second and the fourth Friday. It's Friday Night Joy. So far, we do have a new broadcast that we're working on. Just trying to work out the kinks, amen. And then, of course, on Sundays, we have the Bread of Life, which is the first and the third Sunday of the month, amen. Challenge and Change with Pastor Paul Morgan is every Wednesday, amen, at 7 p.m. Our monthly broadcasts are as follows. Lifeline with Apostle Shirley Jones is every first Monday at 7 p.m. The Bold and Beautiful with Reverend Novena Reed, Reverend Curtis Austin, and Minister Jordana Cunningham is every second Saturday at 10 a.m. Adoration with Evangelist Lewis McILwain is every third Monday of the month. Marriage Takeover, the Body of One with Reverend Pastor Eric and Pastor Temeka Thompson is every fourth Sunday at 7 p.m. Hour 3, Real Life, Real Men, Real Talk with Ray, Antonio, Tyrone, Cleophas, and Elston is every second Sunday at 7 p.m. And our weekly prayer is called Midday Glory Prayer with Reverend Gwen Dixon. That's every Wednesday at 1 p.m. The dial-in number is 712-770-5505. That's its code is 732-499. Matters of the Heart. Singles Ministry is our most recent ministry with myself and Sister Maggie Wilson. Pastor Maggie Wilson is every third Friday at 7 p.m. Please don't forget to check us out on Facebook and other social media sites and like us. Please go to also visit whenchristianspeak.com and find out just a little bit more information there is about us. Amen. With all that being said, thank you for joining us for Friday Night Joy. We can talk a little bit about the horn of salvation. I want to talk about the salvation. Amen. But let's go ahead and open up in prayer, if you don't mind. Father God, we come today first to say thank you. Thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you for all the things that you are doing in our life, God. Thank you for just being God. Thank you for being merciful to us. Thank you for showing us a more excellent way. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for all that you do. For truly you have brought us a mighty long way, God, and we are grateful for it, God. We are grateful for everything that you do in our life, God, for every step that we take. We know that it's ordered by you, God. Every breath that we breathe, God, we know that it's ordered by you. Truly you are Lord and you are God, and we give you all of the glory, God. God, we give you all of the glory. So we pray, God, for those that may be listening to this broadcast today, God. We pray that someone will cry out, what must I do to be saved? We pray, God, that you, God, will begin to break yokes and tear down strongholds, God, and anything and everything that comes contrary to your will. We pray that you will bring forth healing and deliverance. We pray, God, that you will bring forth help, God, whatever is needed, God. But not throughout the nations, God, throughout the cities, God, and the towns, God. We pray, God, for revival like never, ever before, God. We pray, God, that the people may know that salvation is free, God. We pray, God, even for the atheists, the Muslims, and all the different other religions, that they may know, Lord Jesus, that you are the way, that you are the Son of the living God, God. We pray today for the peace of Jerusalem, as always, God. We lift up every single person, Lord Jesus, every pulpit, every pastor, every bishop, every apostle, God, every prophet, God, every evangelist, God, every minister, every elder, every deacon, Lord, we lift them all, every pastor, we lift them all up to you, God, and we prayed in the name of Christ Jesus that a great awakening may take place within the body of Christ, that we, Lord Jesus, we that are called by your name, but begin to humble ourselves and lift up our hands and pray for the healing of the land, Lord Jesus. We know that there is nothing too hard for you to do, God. We trust you. We believe you. We will lean on you and not even on our own understanding, God, but we will wait, Lord Jesus, and see, God, the healing of the healing of the land and the healing of the people, God, and the salvation of the many, God, and those crying out unto you, Lord Jesus. So, Lord Jesus, we give this prayer to you. We give this broadcast to you. We pray that everything that we in this broadcast from the studio and on will work the way that you created it, that it was created to do, that you might get all the glory and all the honor and all the power. In Christ Jesus' name, the resurrected Savior, amen and amen and amen. Amen. This is Friday Night Joy. My name is Reverend Ray, and we're talking about the horn of salvation. I got something I want to read to you. If you give me a minute, I didn't write this. Actually, I got this from the internet, and I was really impressed with the writer. And unfortunately, I didn't don't remember the actual website that I got it off. But this is not my writing, so I want to give credit to the person that wrote this. And it talks about the horn of salvation, and he goes off and says that the horn of salvation is mentioned several times in the Bible. But what does this expression mean? He said, what does salvation have to do with the horn? Yeah, well, I'm glad you asked. Let me read a little bit further and then begin to explain some things to you. It says, in the Old Testament, the word horn signifies many things. Of course, one of the uses of the horn was to refer to a pointy structure growing out of an animal's head, okay, out of an animal's head. That's found in Genesis chapter 22, verses 13. It says, animal horns was used for fighting, protection, and securing dominance and became symbols of strength and power and victory. It says that often scriptures mention of a horn is a literary symbol representing potency and power. So the horn represents our power. It represents strength and everything. And I can remember seeing videos of the ram and other types of animals that had horns but come against each other and stuff that to represent and push each other to represent strength. Okay. And whoever had the most power would be the victory. So when we're talking about the horn of salvation, we talk about something that is full of power. Okay? Full of power. And before I read any further, I'm probably getting ahead of myself. But Jesus is the horn of our salvation. He is completely dominant on everything there is. God, he's the protector. He's our strength. He's all of that and then some. There is none like Jesus. The writer goes on to say, for example, in Daniel chapter 7 and 24, and the 10 horns of Daniel's fourth beast represent 10 kings. And Psalm 75 and 10, God says, I will cut off the horns of all the wicked, but the horns of the righteous will be lifted up. In other words, the horns, the righteous will prevail no matter how strong the wicked seem to be. In other words, y'all, the righteous will prevail no matter how strong God's enemy may be. The righteous, the horn of Jesus Christ, the horn of salvation, which is our Lord and our Savior, will prevail because he's stronger. and with an and an extra he's the strong gift. There is his strength is infinity and beyond, so to speak. There is a little strength like him. He said that the righteous will prevail. Okay? It goes on to say in Jeremiah 48:25, it says that Moab's horn is cut off, means that the strength of Moab is gone. Don't you realize that God will cut off the strength of your enemies when they come against you? The scripture said that when the enemy comes against me like the flood, that God will raise up a standard. He will raise up a banner. He will raise up a standard. He will raise up a banner. That's why we can't be afraid of what the enemy says he's going to do, because in truth and reality, he has no power. He has no power. His power was defeated at the cross. That's why when you see someone that's raging and full of hurtful words and raging like a lion and whatever desire to destroy and everything, but we are covered under the blood, and the enemy has no power. He can't do anything unless God gives him permission to do it. Amen. Let's read on what the writer has said. It says that the four horns in Zechariah 1, chapter 1, verses 18 and 19 represent the powerful nations that attack and scattered Israel. This is true even though there is attacks that are going on within the body of Christ. This COVID virus, and so, just to name a few, there are attacks that's going on and attacking believers from left and right, man. You know, and it's scattering some, and it causes division to some, and it causes some to fall because they're going to get weary in well doing. You know, but the horn and again of the enemy truly is under the feet of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He's been already defeated. It says that animal horns were also used as receptacles for oil or chauffeur trumpet. I think about talked about that before in the past about the chauffeur horn and that how it's time that the chauffeur horn or that horn needs to be blown, and it was used the horn. The chauffeur horn was used to sound the alarm or to bring to assembly those things, to give instructions or direction what should take place next. It says that, let me read back. It says animal horns was also used as receptacles for oil. All right. In other words, that was used for the anointing of the prophets, the anointing of kings, whoever God had set aside, and they needed the anointing to take place in their life. It says that it was anointed with oil. It says that the prayer in Psalms 92:10 contains both a reference to the oil and the figurative use of the horn. So the horn had many uses. One was to use the oil to anoint, to pour over the head of a particular person that was called for ministry. Even now, we use the oil not only to pour on the head of a particular ministry or someone in ministry, but we also use the oil as a way of praying over them by anointing of the oil. Okay? All right, and it says, and also it's a figurative use of the horn. You said the scripture said, "You have exalted my horn like that of a wild ox. Fine oil has been poured upon me." It says, "Fine oil has been poured upon me." And when I think about the horn of salvation, man, all of that, and then some is in it. It's infinity, you know. It says that the grace and the mercy of what the horn of salvation has done for us. In 1 Samuel, the writer goes on. It says in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verses 1, it says, "Hannah praised, in the Lord my horn is lifted high," indicating the strength that would come from her having a child. So she got strength from hearing that she was going to have a child. The horn of my salvation, he gives us the strength. When I'm weak, I become strong only because of the grace and the mercy of Jesus Christ. He makes us strong when we're weak. You know, he's the horn of our salvation. He's the strength of our non-strength. He's the strength when we run out of strength. He's our strength, y'all, when we lack of strength. And when we don't know what else to do, we can depend, we can lean, we can do whatever it takes on him because we know that God has us. Amen. It says in Luke chapter, Luke chapter 1, verse 69, it says that Zacchaeus praises God that he has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David. In this case, the horn of salvation is the reference to Jesus Christ. That's what we're talking about. The powerful deliverer and the king who was soon to be born, our Lord and our Savior, the Son of the living God, the horn of our salvation, the strength of our salvation, the one that will forgive our sins, the one that will die on the cross so that we may live again, the one that will give us the opportunity to go beyond the veil, the one that will allow us to walk in the garden in the cool of the day. Another significant instance of the word horn in the Old Testament is a reference to the protrusion at each corner of the altar. In worship, the horns of the altar were dabbed with the blood to purify them and make atonement for sin. Isn't this like Jesus? Isn't this like Jesus Christ? You know, that we have been atoned and everything like that. But there was no more atonement after Christ. He was the complete, the full atonement. Amen. He was the full, the complete and full atonement. You know, he wasn't just dabbed with blood and everything, y'all, but he was crucified. He had to bleed for us to live, okay? When they pierced him in the side, the scripture said that water and blood, when they came out of the side, when they beat him all night long, you know, there were stripes, many stripes on the back of for us, y'all. Jesus Christ, the horn of our salvation, died for our salvation. He died that we might live and not die. Isn't that awesome to know about? The horn of our salvation. It says that in Leviticus chapter 8, verses 15 and 4 and 6, it says the horn of the altar speak of the power of God's salvation. That part of the altar also became a place of refuge and sanctuary for a fugitive. In other words, y'all, we were once fugitive, but because of Jesus Christ and because he is the horn of our salvation, we can have life. We have been rescued. We have been taken away from the death doors and everything. Death and the sting of death don't no longer have any power or anything over us. You know, all because the horn of salvation through Jesus Christ, which offered us salvation. Now, that was shared with Reverend Robin. Reverend Robin shared with me earlier, and she said that the salvation is, we were talking about the salvation being free, but we also know that there are times and everything, as long as man's hands don't mess it up, you know, because what man does, they take something that is free and put a price tag or put law on it, but that's the subject for a different day, okay? I mean, salvation is free, the horn of salvation. It says, we often see the horn in scriptures as a symbol of salvation. Psalms 18:2 says, the Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, and my rock in whom I take refuge. He's my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. It says, my stronghold. The horn of my salvation, the Lord, my salvation, is in the strength of the Lord. I'm not worried about anyone coming trying to take my salvation away because they can't do it because we are in Christ Jesus. You know, we've been bought with a price. There's a price that was paid for each and every last one of us. The horn of our salvation, Lord. Thank you. Okay. All right. Then let me move on. Get that. And then in Luke chapter 6 to 8, that's a title applied to Yahweh. It's always applied to Jesus. They are both called the horn of salvation. The very name Jesus means the Lord is salvation, y'all. The very name of Jesus Christ, Jesus means the Lord is salvation. The salvation Jesus offers us is strong, is unmerited, you know, it's full of strength. It would never, ever waver in everything. Like, no matter what we've done, no matter what our lifestyles were, it's strong and it's full of power. It's full of power. It's full of forgiveness. It's full of that second chance and that third chance and that fourth chance. Okay, it's full of like that. It says, just like the horns of the altar offer refuge and atonement, and I said this earlier, offer clemency and cleansing through his death on the cross. Clemency, y'all. We have clemency because of the blood of Jesus Christ. Then there's a part that we have to play. We have to confess his name, and we have to believe within our heart and say his name in our mouth. There's the things that have to come in place. But Jesus, the scripture said that Jesus died for the sins of the whole world. He didn't just die for the Jew or the Greek or the Gentile, but for the sins for the whole world. You know, they're for the sins of the whole world. Amen. So Jesus offers, let me read this again. Jesus offers clemency and cleansing through his death on the cross. However strong our spiritual foe is, the horn of our salvation is stronger still. Still. 2,000 years ago, it was stronger, and it's stronger still. Nothing has changed. Nothing has changed with the power and the grace of the Almighty God that we serve. Nothing has changed because of the salvation that he was offered to, that was been offered to us, you know, offered to us for those that was lost and headed to hell gates. Nothing has changed for us. He's the same today and tomorrow and forevermore. He changed not. The scripture says he changed not. He changed not. But the desire, God has desired that no man should be lost. No man. He doesn't desire anyone to be lost. That's why he offered through Christ that salvation unto you. Salvation unto you, whoever you may be, wherever you may be. There is a salvation that's offered to you that is free. That is free. Amen? That is free. Let me read a couple one more ones. And I want to go back to Psalms. This is Psalms 18, chapter 18, verses 1. It says, this is David speaking. He said, I will love thee, O Lord, my strength. He said, I will love thee, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my strength. See, mention the word strength. He said, I will love thee, my strength. Okay, in whom I will trust, my buckler and the horn of my salvation, my high tower. He said, you know, he began to acclaim these are all the things that God has meant to him. And those things that David mentioning here are all the things that God has mentioned. He called it, he's in my high tower, you know. In other words, I'm in a defense city. I'm not worried about the enemy coming after me or anything like that, because God is not only my fortress, but he's my high tower. He said, I would trust. He said, call it my buckler. A buckler is like a small shield and everything that is used for close combat fighting and everything. Like you say, he's my buckler, you know. So when the enemy gets too close, I'm bringing up the buckler. I'm bringing up the buckler of my God. I'm bringing up the buckler of Christ to defeat the enemy, because in close combat, you know, it gets heavy. That hand-to-hand combat is needed. And sometimes in life, y'all, we need to be in a position where that we need to do spiritual warfare, and it's close combat. You know, the enemy is right there staring you in your face, maybe cussing you out at the time and stuff. And you need to be in a place that even in the midst of that, you can use the spiritual warfare at your disposal. You can begin to speak the mysteries of the prayer. You know, the Bible says the prayers of a righteous man availeth much. And sometimes the best thing is not those prayers that we say out loud, but those quiet, silent prayers that everybody can hear, you know, that we ushering right in the midst of what the enemy is doing, or what the enemies may be declaring, or what the enemy might be perpetrating, or the enemy might be trying to plan something. You know, and we know that the God that we serve, because he is the horn of our salvation, will begin to come in right in the midst and thwart the enemy's plan. We know that he will begin to thwart the enemy's plan. What the enemy meant for evil, God will take it and turn it around for our good. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. He'll take it and turn it around for our good. Let me continue to read on in Psalms chapter 18. Verse 3 says that I will call upon the Lord. He is worthy, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. All we got to do, sometimes we need to open our mouth and begin to call upon the Lord. You know, call upon the Lord while he's near, you know. He said, so shall I be saved from my enemies. Verse 4 said, the sorrows of death compassed me, and the floods of ungodly men made me afraid. Look, this don't mean you won't be afraid, because sometimes they present themselves full of terror, but we got to believe and we got to remember who we are in Christ Jesus. You know, there was somebody in the Bible, God told him, he said, I'm going to make your face like flint. He said, "Don't be afraid." He told them, "Don't be afraid of their faces." He said, "I'm gonna make your face like plant and everything like that. You know, I'm gonna do it like that. You know, don't be afraid of what comes out of their mouth of face." In other words, he was telling the prophet, he said, "I called you for this." Okay, he says, "Though the sorrows, though the sorrows of death compassed me, and the floods of ungodly men made me afraid." Verse 5 said, "The sorrows of hell compassed me about. The snares of death prevented me in my distress." There we go, y'all. "I called upon the Lord and cried unto my God, and he heard my voice out of his temple, and my cry came before him, even in his ears." Even in his ears, y'all. God is there for us. The scripture said that he promised never to leave us nor forsake us. He didn't say that we wouldn't have trials and tribulation. No, he didn't say that at all. In fact, he said, if they wanted to kill me, they're going to want to kill you. If the enemy is going to come against me and I'm the Lord, they're going to definitely come against you, you know. But he gave us advice. He gave us instructions on even how to handle that. Amen. He gave us instructions even how to handle this. Now, I want to read another scripture. This is coming out of Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. And it says, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, that not of yourselves." Okay? "It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them." Yeah, we've been ordained already. There's ordained already to walk in this right here. You know, we don't have to do it with our own works. We don't have to put no effort into it. All we got to do is just let go and let God. You know, and realize that we've been bought with the price. And realize that salvation is ours. The price of salvation, y'all, is with us no matter what. God, the one thing I do like about this, that God doesn't take his salvation away from us. No matter how many times we mess up, no matter how many times we say and do the wrong, his salvation is still there for us. I can see Jesus in my own sight, y'all, just in my own way, just having open arms towards us. Just come here over here, daughter. Come on over here, son. Let me put my arms around you. Yeah, I know you made a mistake, but I got you covered. Yeah, I know the pain is great at times, and I know that the suffering is great at times. Just bear with me, because weeping may endure for night, but my joy is coming in the morning. Your healing is coming in the morning. I can see Jesus just grabbing a hold of us and say, I'm going to hold on to you. You know, you're not alone in this. Some of us are going through some things right now that we feel so alone, so isolated, especially with the virus and everything that's going on with it. We're losing the job. The income is not there. No help is on the way. But I know Jesus cares. I know and I believe that he is a way maker. You know, he's a way maker. That's the song. He's a way maker. You know, and all that we got to do, and I'm speaking to myself, is hold to his hand. They used to sing that song back in the old days. They don't sing songs like that anymore. Hold to his hand. God's unchanging the hands. The times is filled with swift transition, you know, and everything. But we got to continue to hold to his hand no matter what. You know, hold on to the horn of salvation. Hold on to our faith. Hold on to our relationship with Jesus Christ, and don't give up. Don't take down. Don't throw in the towel. Keep that towel. Go ahead and dry your tears. Whatever is needed, hold on to God. This is the time and the season that we're living in now. Hold on. Be diligent in the things of God, you know. Don't be in situations that will cause you to stumble and fail. Avoid those situations. Run like crazy if you have to stumble. But avoid those situations. God wants us, the people of God, that are called by his name, to continue to hold on and not give up. To hold on and not give up. Let me finish reading Ephesians chapter 2 verse 8. I think I stopped at verse 10. It says that, "For we are all his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them." This is a walk, y'all. This is a walk that we walk by faith and not by sight. This is a walk that we walk in bond of the Holy Spirit. We're not walking alone, okay? This is a walk that the just shall live by. This is the type of walk that we didn't let go of God. Even in the midst of we getting tired, like I talked about earlier, then we know that God is our strength. You know, God, I don't know whether I can take another step, but if you tell me to go, I'm gone. I'm going to take another step because I believe that you will give me the strength to take that extra step. You know, sometimes I believe, and it's just me talking, sometimes I wonder, do we miss out on a blessing that's for us because we just give up right at the door when the blessing is about to, someone's about to knock on the door. You said, that's it, I can't take it. And we compromise and we go and we do something that is contrary right at the point that the blessing. That's why it's the patience of waiting on God is important. And I'm speaking to you and I'm speaking to myself because I have to tell myself, Lord, Ray, wait on God. See what God's going to do. He's not finished with this yet. Take your hands. Because most times what we do, even though we know that we believe in the horn of salvation, we put our hands on it and we have a tendency to make it worse. We have a tendency to make it worse. Amen. Let me read on. This is coming out of 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 and 21. It says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature, y'all. You know, because of the horn of salvation, because of Jesus Christ is our horn, and because he's our strength, and because he's our leader, and because he's the Son of the living God, and because he's our friend, and because he's our Lord and Master, and everything, and because of the death of the cross, we are become new creature. Okay? It says all things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. We are new. We are not the same as we was yesterday or the day before or last year. We are constantly growing into something new that God has ordained and chosen for such a time as this. You know, and everything. That's why we got to be careful about when we mess up or we fall and stuff, because we have to be careful about judging ourselves up, beating ourselves up and everything. We have to be careful there because that's what the enemy wants for us to take place. He wants to be beaten down and beaten to a pulp and everything, that was to the point that we can't get back up again, to a point that we've lost all hope and everything. But I know that my God that we serve is the restorer of all hope. Amen. That he's the restorer of all hope. Verse 18, he said that all things are of God who has reconciled us unto himself by Jesus Christ. All things are of God. Y'all, who have reconciled us. We've been reconciled. You know, salvation is free. We've been reconciled, y'all, unto Jesus, to himself by Jesus Christ, and have given to us the ministry of reconciliation. We can show others, listen, if God did it for me through Jesus Christ, he can do it for you. Let me tell you about salvation. Let me tell you about what Jesus did. Let me tell you that you don't have to worry. Let me tell you that you can live and not die. Let me tell you about the price, the cost that was paid for at the cross. Let me tell you about how he rose again early one Sunday morning. Let me tell you what took place and everything. Let me tell you how he's coming back one day. Let me tell you that you can have the gift of the Holy Spirit fall on you today. It's a gift. It's yours. All it takes is just you asking. Let me tell you, the scripture said that he's coming back in the twinkling of an eye. Let me tell you that every eye should see him. Let me tell you that the dead in Christ shall rise first. Let me tell you, that he calls us friends. He called us friends, y'all. Let me tell you about that. Let me tell you about this salvation. Amen. Let me continue to read on. To wit, verse 19, to wit that God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, have committing unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then we are ambassadors for Christ, y'all, as though God did beseech you by us. We are ambassadors in Christ. Once you become a believer in Christ, we become ambassadors in Christ. We are in the world, but we're not of the world. We're ambassadors, meaning that we bring forth the gospel. You know, people say, there's a lot of people say, well, I'm not called to preach. Yes, you are. All of us are, and everything. All of us are called to preach. We, and being ambassadors, we bring the good news or the good tidings of Christ to people that may not know. And we bring it even to those that may know and stuff like and things like that, because they may have forgot. They may be in a backslidden state and everything. So the purpose is to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ. We are ambassadors, you know, we in a foreign land, but this is, we don't live here, you know, we don't have, we have a place that we stay here, but this is not our main residence, okay, this is not our main residence. The whole purpose of us to be here is to go into the hedges and the highways and to compare men and women to come in to find out about this salvation, to find out about this Jesus Christ and Lord and Savior that we serve. That's what it's about, to find out about this Jesus Christ, the Lord and Savior that we serve. He said, verse 20 again says, now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you, and Christ did, be ye reconciled to God. That's the task, y'all. Be ye reconciled to God, for he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. The righteousness of God in him, y'all. He, Jesus Christ, knew no sin. There was no guile or anything found in him. Everything that the Jews and the Romans gave was fabricated. It was all a lie. You know, no, he was the sheep of all sheep. He was the sheep without blemish. He was. He was the lamb laid to the led to the slaughter for us. That blood laid for us, y'all. For salvation, so did God consult us the mysteries of and the allegories, and that should make you feel good, you know, right then and there. You know, that God loved us so much that he gave his only begotten Son, you know, for us. That whosoever believed in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Everlasting life. It's free, y'all. It's free. I don't care where you, what state of mind you are. I don't care whether you've been drinking or I don't care when you've been doing all kinds of crazy. That God has to, Jesus Christ has forgiven you your sins on the cross. And his hands are open wide to you today to receive him, that he might come in and be with you and you be with him. He's standing there knocking at your door today. Won't you let him in? Let him in. Let him in. Let him in. The righteousness of God. I want to read verse 21 again, and we're almost out of time. Amen. It says, for he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. That we might be made the righteousness of God in him, not our own righteousness. We can't do it. There's nothing. In fact, our righteousness is like, what, 50 rags, man. We can't do it. There's nothing that we can do to become righteous. Nothing. I don't care how many times you go to the church. I don't care if you sing in the choir. I don't care if you preach every Sunday and bring the house there. I don't care if you have the song, the voice of our angels, and they can rock the house. I don't care. But even with all of that, we're not righteous on our own self. Our righteousness of God is through Jesus Christ, okay? And God is in Christ. In Christ, y'all. Nothing that we do is righteous. It's only through Christ Jesus that we're made righteous. It's only through him. Nothing. Amen. I want to read a couple of scriptures, then we're going to go ahead and get out of here, okay? This is coming from Acts chapter 16, verses 30 and 31. And it says, and I should have probably started a little earlier, brought them out and said, sirs, this is talking about when, let me turn to it real quick in my Bible here. Give me 1 second. I want to make sure I get this right. But basically what it's dealing with, let me see here. Okay, Acts. See if I can find my Bible online here. Right. Let's see, Acts. Amen. Praise God. 16. That's where I want to go. Amen. Amen. I want to see where the Amen. And actually, this was during the time that we had, let me go back a little further. Paul and Silas was in prison. And they was put in prison because they rebuked this woman that has the spirit of they had a spirit upon her. And she had made a lot of money and much gain, the scripture says in 16:16, as a soothsayer. And she would cry behind Paul and say, I'm saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which will show us the more us the way of salvation. So she's going around saying this over and over and over and over again. And she wasn't wrong. She said, these are servants of the Most High God, which will show unto us the way of salvation. Okay, check this out. And the scripture says, 18 says, and this she did many days. But Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the spirit, the small s, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out that same hour. The scripture came out of this moment that same hour. Can you imagine you're trying to do ministry and somebody just kept saying the same thing over and over? Yeah, I think Paul was grieved by that. Yeah, I can see Paul being grieved by that. Let me go ahead. Verse 19 says, and when her master saw that the hope of the gains were gone, they caught Paul and Silas and drew them to the marketplace unto the ruler. In other words, they was mad because their money maker was gone, y'all. Okay, and brought them to the magistrate, saying, these men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our city. They weren't troubling the city. They was mad because their money maker was gone. The girl couldn't do what she was doing before, and teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither observe, being Romans. And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrate ripped off their clothes and commanded them to be beaten. In other words, they got the crowd involved. Let me continue the reading. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely. Okay, they threw them into prison. They beat them up, all right, and then cast them into prison. Got all these people against them, then they cast them into prison, okay? It says, 24 says, and who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast into stocks. Now they locked them, chains and everything. And this is the verse that we can get through 30, okay? It said, and at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed. They prayed, y'all, and sang praises unto God. And the prisoners heard them. Now they were singing so much and singing so loud that even the other prisoners heard them, y'all. You know, talking about having church, they was having church at midnight, Paul and Silas were. And verse 26 says, and suddenly there came, there was a great earthquake, so that the foundation of the prison was shaken, and immediately all the doors were open, and everyone's bands was loose. It said, the scripture said, everyone's bands were loose. That's all the prisoners, not just Paul and Silas, but all the prisoners, bands was loose. Okay? The foundation was shaken, and all the doors were open, y'all. Can you imagine, you know, what was going on? You know, and this verse I want to get to, the other one I want to get to. Verse 27 says, 16:27, Acts chapter 16, verse 27. And it says, the keeper of the prison awakened out of his sleep, seeing the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. He saw all the prison doors open and everything. He was ready just to do himself right then and there. But 28 said, but Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, do thyself no harm, for we are all here. Nobody tried to get out. They all stayed, even the other prisoner. Nobody left, y'all. Nobody left, okay? Then it says, 29 said, then he called for light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas. And he brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? You often hear me use that scripture in my prayer. He said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Here, the prison doors were open, the chains were broken, and everything. He knew that something went, what must I do to to be saved, you know? And verse 31 says, and they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house. Now, the reason I wanted to read that scripture, because this all started with a certain, let me go back to the place, all right? With a certain damsel, with the spirit of divination, I know I'm saying that right, divination, that was gaining a lot of money for the suicide, going about saying that these men are the servants of the Most High God, and would show us the way of salvation. That's how this got started, because of that. Yeah, showing us salvation, and at the end, somebody received salvation. But the scripture goes on. I didn't read further along. It talks about not just him, but his whole house received salvation. Now, the scripture talks about, but what about the other people who might have heard it? The voice, they might have heard the sermon, they might have heard the testimony, or saw. I'm sure there was other gods that saw what happened. What about all of them? We don't know. But this man received salvation in his whole house. Okay? Salvation, y'all, is for us today, and it's free. The price was paid for it on the cross. When Jesus said that it is finished, that's what he was talking about. It is finished. Whatever way but the way that we needed to know was him, through Jesus Christ. Him. There's no other way, y'all. No other way except through Jesus Christ. We cannot even get to the Father without coming through Jesus Christ. You know, I know there's many different religions that teach other things, but you can't get to the Father without coming through Jesus Christ. He's the way. You know, he is the way. Amen and amen. And I'm done. I'm done, amen. I'm just going to go ahead and just close out in prayer. I see that Reverend Robin is with me. I'm not sure if she have anything to say and everything like that, but if you do, Reverend Robin, you can speak if you like, but I want to go ahead and close out in prayer. Reverend Robin, are you there with me?
I am. I've just been blessed by listening to the word. It's just been awesome just to know that salvation is there for us and it's free. And just to know that God continually knocks upon our hearts to draw us closer to him. And it's just an awesome place to have a Savior such as Jesus Christ, because it's a firm place to be in. It's oh, my gosh, it's without our effort, you know. It's grace given to us. It's not earned. It's not based on a merit system. It's not based on what we can ante up, because we really can't ante up anything. But like you said, you know, salvation is free. It's by grace we are saved. Mm. By grace we are saved. So we just bless God for his salvation. It's just, we have salvation to the fullest of the definition. We have truly been rescued. We have been rescued and set in a safe place in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Mm. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Reverend Robin. Amen. I'm just telling you, like Reverend Robin, salvation is free. It's by grace. It's yours. I don't care who you are, where you've been through, where you're from. I don't care about what the color of your skin. I don't care even that you may have started off in a different religion. Let me tell you about Jesus Christ. Salvation is free for you today. The price was paid for you to be free. To walk no more in bondage. It's not about religion, Baptist, Pentecost, you know, and all the different other ones, Presbyterians, other different ones that's out there. Come to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior for yourself. Come to know him as your Lord and Savior as yourself. He is open. He has arms open wide just for you today. You are not alone. Amen. You are not alone. God has purpose for your life today. Amen. Let's go ahead and close out in prayer. Father God, we just want to thank you for the word that has gone forth, God. We want to thank you, Lord Jesus, that someone today, God, may be hearing this word about salvation for the first time, God. We pray, Lord Jesus, you begin to prick them in their heart, God. And we pray that you begin to bring chastisement, that you will bring correction, God, that you would begin, the Lord Jesus, to circumcise that heart, that they might cry out, truly, what must I do to be saved, God? We pray not only for them, Lord Jesus, but those that they are attached to, God. We pray that they will find a loving Holy Spirit believing church, Lord Jesus, that will love on them, that will disciple them, God, that will show them your way, God. We pray even for the freshness of the Holy Spirit, that they will receive it in the name of Christ Jesus, God. We pray today, Lord Jesus, that this will be a new day for them, that this will be a birthday for them, God, that they receive, they open up their heart to you, Lord Jesus. But only you know the what's really in their heart. You know their desires, God. We pray, Lord Jesus, today that you would give them dreams and visions of your purpose and your plans that you have for them. We pray today, God, that you would anoint them with your oil, Lord Jesus, and allow it to overflow like on Aaron's beard, Lord Jesus. We pray today, God, that you would bring them even closer to you, Lord Jesus. We pray for every sickness and disease and every ism that might be, God, that's coming against them, God, to be rebuked and to be put under the feet, Lord Jesus, in victory, that they might have the essence of joy of the Lord, who is the strength of his people, your joy, God. We pray for joy. We pray for praise and worship, God, to begin to operate in them, God. We are praying today, God, for a new creature, yes, Lord Jesus, to take place in our life, God. We're praying today, Lord Jesus, not only for that, but there may be someone that have backslided. There may be someone that have turned away, God. You said that you're married even to the backslider, God. We pray, God, that they might return back unto you, God. But they might understand, Lord Jesus, that you never left. You are still there. That everything that they have done, Lord Jesus, everything they have said has been already dealt with, has been nailed to the cross. God, you knew that when we fall, that when we fall down, that you knew, Lord Jesus, how long it would be down. But I thank you, God, that you were there to pick us up, God. So we pray victory, God. We pray, God, that you will open up their eyes that they might and reveal to them, Lord Jesus, that there'll be more that would be with them than be against them, God. We pray that you would send ministering angels that their way, Lord, to tap them on the shoulder and to remind them of the love of Christ, God. We pray that prayer today, God. And then, God, we continue to pray for the people of God. We pray for every bishop, every apostle, every pastor, Lord Jesus, every prophet, every apostle, God, every evangelist, God, every intercessor, every missionary, every deacon, God, even the ministers of music, Lord Jesus, even those that ushers in the door, God, those that keep the church clean. You know those that are doing the work, God, we pray even for them, Lord Jesus, the body of Christ, that you would draw us even closer and closer to you, Lord Jesus, that we might begin to understand the seasons and the times that we're living in today, God, that we might not turn to the left nor towards the right, but stay focused on the things of you, God. We thank you in advance. We thank you for Reverend Robin joining us today. Continue to bless her in her coming in and her going out, Lord Jesus. We thank you for this broadcast, God. This broadcast, God, this network is all about you. You get all the glory, God. You get all the honor, God. You get all the praise, God. All we want to continue to do, God, is bring forth the word and teach it, God, and bring forth things that can help people out in this last and evil days that we live in today, God. We will forever give you all the glory, God, and all the praise and all the honor. We thank you again, Lord Jesus. Have mercy on us, Lord Jesus. Continue to keep us safe from harm, God. Continue to keep us on our face daily, Lord Jesus, seeking after you, Lord Jesus. Allow us to study those days, Lord Jesus, that we need to study. Allow us to let those days go that we need to let go, Lord Jesus. We will give you all the praise. In Christ Jesus' name, amen and amen and amen. Amen. Again, I want to thank you for listening to When Christians Speak Talk Radio. This has been Friday Night Joy. This is Reverend Ray. I had been joined with Reverend Robin. I'm so glad that she was on with me today. I like seeing her on. Even she don't say much sometimes, but I like seeing her on. Yeah, it's good to see you, cuz, and everything. So y'all be blessed. Y'all be blessed. And don't forget about the broadcast that we got coming up. God bless you. Know that we love you. Amen. See you on Sunday. God bless you. Amen. God, see you, Robert.
God bless. Amen.
God bless.